grace, O Lord, to answer readily the call of our Savior Jesus Christ, and proclaim to all people the good news of his salvation, that we and all the whole world may perceive the glory of his marvelous works, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. The first reading is from the prophet Jeremiah. A voice on the bare heights is heard, the plaintive weeping of Israel's children, because they have perverted their way. They have forgotten the Lord their God. Return, O faithless children. I will heal your faithlessness. Here we come to you, for you are the Lord our God. Truly, the hills are a delusion, the orgies on the mountains. Truly, in the Lord our God is the salvation of Israel. But from our youth, the shameful thing has devoured all for which our ancestors had labored, their flocks and their herds, their sons and their daughters. Let us lie down in our shame, and let our dishonor cover us. For we have sinned against the Lord our God, we and our ancestors, from our youth even to this day, and we have not obeyed the voice of the Lord our God. If you return, O Israel, says the Lord, if you return to me, if you remove your abominations from my presence, and do not waver, and if you swear, as the Lord lives, in truth, in justice, and in uprightness, then nations shall be blessed by him, and by him they shall boast. Here ends the lesson. The nations shall fear your name, O Lord,
and all the kings of the earth your glory.
For the Lord will build up Zion,
and his glory shall appear. The second reading is from the Gospel of Mark. Now after John was arrested, Jesus came to Galilee proclaiming the good news of God and saying, "The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news." As Jesus passed along the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the lake, for they were fishermen. And Jesus said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fish for people." And immediately they left their nets and followed him. As he went a little farther, he saw James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, who were in the boat, mending their nets. Immediately he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men and followed him. Here ends the lesson. Have you ever noticed our human tendency to blame God for virtually all the bad things and the hard things that happen in our lives? We blame God for things like earthquakes, flood, disease, death. We blame God for the everyday and regular tragedies of our lives, a breakup, an accident, bounced checks, brawling kids. Somehow, everything that goes wrong at times can seem to be blamed on God. And the people and our problems, we never get tired of sort of complaining to God about how difficult things are to handle. Sometimes it feels like God has abandoned us. Now the message of Christmas, which is, we're still really kind of in the season of Christmas and Epiphany, the message of Christmas is that God has not abandoned us. It is actually that God has found us. God has come into our very real and very messy lives. In a very real way, God has found us, just as in our gospel story, Jesus walks along the lake, and he finds Simon and Andrew, and he finds James and John, fishing ordinary lives, and asks them to come and follow. Now, our lives are busy. I mean, the fishermen, you know, they're busy. They get up at 2 a.m., 3 a.m. to go fishing. Our lives are busy, too. And God comes to us in the midst of those messy lives. God comes to us when things seem convoluted, when things seem confusing. You see, in Christmas cards, we have pictures of Jesus at the stable. And those pictures in those Christmas cards, they're always kind of idyllic. You know, they're perfect. In some way, the star is just perfect, and the angels are perfect, and the shepherds who come are clean. But you know, a real stable isn't like that. A real stable is a very messy place. You see, God is found in what I'm going to call our stable moments, our everyday moments. Now, God is found on the beach when you go walk, see a sunrise or a sunset. And God is found perhaps in a retreat, in a monastery or up on a mountain. But more often, God is found in the everyday, the unpredictable, our messy lives. Even in this world confronted with a pandemic, God can be found. And God is found in the midst of it. You see, as modern people, we tend to live our lives in a fast lane. And I think perhaps what this pandemic has done is it has made us slow down. Just a little bit, perhaps, to pay attention to what God is doing. You see, we're used to things in what I'm going to call the fast lane. We are used to things happening quickly. So we have fast food restaurants. We have Burger King and McDonald's and Yoshinoya and Starbucks. Things so that we can have things the way we want them, quickly and easily. We have microwaves so that we don't have to wait for our food to be heated up. Anything that is like frozen or packaged or freeze-dried is almost assured of success because we want to do things quickly. We are people in a hurry. But God breaks through in the hurriedness, and perhaps even more from time to time when we slow down. It's not just meals that we rush through. We rush through lots of things in life. We have things like instant soup. And we want things like instant success, instant solutions to our problems. Why can't somebody or God just snap his fingers and fix our problems? That would be great, wouldn't it? If God would just answer with a snap of the fingers, fix whatever was wrong in our life, just fix this thing for me today and I'll be fine. I think it's probably why we like Superman so much. If you think about all the stories about Superman, Superman never wonders or ponders or thinks about the rescue. Superman just acts. He just flies in, scoops up Lois Lane, and everything is fine. That's probably why we like those comic strips, those things about Superman, because things are solved instantly. But life isn't like that. In religion, too, we want unambiguous answers. We want an answer versus ambiguity. And I think that's probably why some of the big megachurches grow so rapidly, is because they are willing to provide answers. But I'm not sure that religion provides answers. Religion sometimes helps us ponder the questions, ponder what meaning in life is all about. You see, in Jesus' day, people were looking for a hero, just like a Superman, to come and save them too. They were living under Roman oppression. They were living in poverty. They wanted a savior who would fix things for them. Just like us, we want things in our lives fixed. But that isn't what Jesus comes to do. Jesus, while he did miracles, was not just a wonder worker. Jesus was a healer. And sometimes healing takes time. We know that. Every time you have just even a little cut, you know, even a little paper cut, you know it's going to take time to heal. Things don't happen overnight. Now, we would like for a hero to rush in to kind of save us, to make our lives perfect. But Jesus doesn't come like that. It's not about speedy solutions. You see, God did not come here to fix things for us. God did not come as a Superman. But Jesus, God did send Jesus Christ. Jesus, who is just as vulnerable and weak as we are. So instead of fixing everything, God promises to walk with us, to be on the journey with us. In a world that wants a Superman, Jesus does not come that way. Jesus comes as a person, a human being, who will walk with us. Jesus was born in a stable, not in a perfectly clean hospital room. Jesus was born in a stable, not with a warm bed, safe and secure, actually running from authorities. Jesus was born in a stable. And if you think about it, stables don't really even have nice, clean straw. They're dirty, muddy, awful straw. Jesus was born into a messy world. But the wonderful thing is that Jesus comes into this messy world that we share. And Jesus knows that we live in this messy place. I'd like to share with you a story. A Hasidic story. You know anything about the Hasidic Jews? It's a tradition within Judaism. The Hasidic Jews are a mystical tradition in Judaism. So the story goes like this. Once upon a time, there was a carefree young girl who lived at the edge of the forest. One day, she wandered into the forest, but she got lost. It grew dark. And she searched and searched to find her way back home. She did not return home. And in the searching, she finally gave up. It was getting dark. It was getting low. She finally lay down in a clearing and fell asleep. Meanwhile, the parents have become frantic. They have not been able to find the little girl. She has not come home. They start searching. They get the neighbors to come and help. The neighbors to come and search the forest to try to find the little girl. They search day, all day, and they search into the night. Finally, the neighbors one by one go home. They give up, but the father never gives up. He keeps searching. He keeps searching. And suddenly, in the early morning, when the light is just beginning to come up, the father sees his little girl in the clearing. And as he runs towards the clearing where she is sleeping, he steps on branches, and the noise wakes her up. The little girl sees her father, and she shouts, "Daddy, Daddy, I found you." God is like that. God finds us even when we don't know that we are searching. This is the heart of the message of the Incarnation, that God has found us. God may have found us lost, or alone, or virtually directionless. God has found us perhaps in the busyness, messiness of everyday life. And just as God in Jesus found Peter and Andrew, he found James and John. The simple bare fishermen things, whatever fishermen knew, they were busy. In the messiness of that life, Jesus found them. And what happens, too, is that in the midst of our lives, Jesus finds us. God has come down and found us. In the midst of bosses, busyness, bounce checks, whatever our lives are seem messy, God does come and God does find us. The glad and glorious news of salvation is that in our busy and hectic lives, in this sometimes fearful and messy world, Jesus comes. We have been found by God. Even today, we are found by God. Amen.
Let us pray. As God is moved by the sincerity of our repentance, so too God is pleased by the faithfulness of our prayers. Let us offer our prayers to God. You have called us, O God, to follow you. Give us the grace to listen to your call, to lay aside the things of this world, and to follow you. In your mercy, hear our prayer. You have sent us, O God, into the world to tell the story of your love and faithfulness. Give us a holy seal for the proclamation of the gospel in this place and in all the world. In your mercy, hear our prayer. You have called, O God, persons with varieties of gifts to serve your church. Bless, we pray, the ministries of musicians and artists, scholars and writers, pastors and teachers, that their work enrich our common life and offer us a glimpse of the life to come. In your mercy, hear our prayer. You gave life, O God, for us and for all people. We remember before you those who are sick. Those who mourn. Those who are alone or afraid. Those who are persecuted for their beliefs. And those who rejoice. As you have reached out to us in love, so inspire us to be present to those we have named before you. In your mercy, hear our prayer. As we are faithful in prayer, O God, so make us faithful in following you, that loving and serving you all the days of our lives, we may know the joy of the resurrection and may look with longing for your coming in power. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Gathering these prayers together, as well as those that we hold in the silence of our own hearts, we pray in the words that Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. May Christ, the Son of God, be manifest in you, that your lives may be a light to the world, and the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always. Go now in peace to love and serve the Lord. Alleluia. Alleluia. I want to thank you for joining us this Sunday, the third Sunday of Epiphany. And I would like to invite you, members of St. Albans and friends of St. Albans, to join us for the annual parish meeting this afternoon, 2 p.m. on Zoom. And you can access that through our website. It's an important meeting. We elect new vestry, approve the budget, all those things that a congregation has to do once a year. And I do hope that you will be able to attend. Thank you.